Hey, y'all. Thank y'all so much for coming and tuning in with us. Kyren is back this week, y'all. So we're coming in to present to you all another amazing episode per usual. We are coming with the information. We did a lot of research, so we're going to be referring to our notes today because the way that we're moving as far as bringing you these topics, it's getting a little bit more in-depth, a little bit more serious, or a lot bit more serious, I'm going to say. And it is just something that we want to make sure that we're giving you accurate information to the best of our knowledge and ability. So this week's episode is going to piggyback off of last week's, but we're going to insert Sean Carter this week, and I'm going to elaborate more on his interactions with the occultic practices, all of the vile things that he's been doing illegally in the industry to rise to billionaire status. So this week's episode is called Jay-Z, the Rose-Colored Glasses Used to See This Empire State of Mind Mogul and the Dark Side of the Real Sean Carter.
Here we go.
Exposed. So, y'all, we're just going to jump right into it because we ain't got no time to waste. So Jay-Z, Sean Corey Carter, was born December 4th in 1969. He was born to two parents that were collectively together as a child. Now, later on, they did part ways, but for a good portion of his life, they were together. And when I did some research, I looked at primitive years for children, and I found out some very interesting information. When a child is in their primitive years, it's about from the point of them being born until about five. And so this is where their brain development is rapid, where a lot of their cognitive abilities are moving, and where they grasp a lot of life's very basic concepts, right? And it's also where parents are nurturing or not, depending on what type of parents are raising them, and maturing them in such a way that they can learn to be independent and on their own. Now, because I talked to you guys before about narcissism, my task this time around is to bring to you all a specific type of narcissism, which is what God wanted us to report on today, and it's covert narcissism. Covert narcissism looks like someone that has character traits that run in a cyclical pattern of love bombing, devaluing, and then discarding their victims. And so when you think about covert narcissism, narcissistic personality disorder overall is it shows traits of people having lack of being able to take accountability, being able to regulate their emotions like we talked about in the primitive years as a child. And it also talks about just being able to be in social settings and have a lack of confidence. They have a very inflated sense of self. And so a lot of the validation that they seek and that they need to feel sustained in this life comes from their relationships with other people, being able to control and to take advantage of and manipulate other people. That's what covert narcissism truly looks like. Now, covert is different than most of the other forms because in covert narcissism, you can't really detect that right away. A grandiose narcissist is someone that's loud, bodacious. I'm here. Look at me. I'm the best at all the things that I do. And they are in your face with it. But when you think about covert narcissists, they're almost like quiet with it. It's almost like, woe is me. They're always a victim and everybody never sees their glory and their amazing vibes in their way until they get power, fame, and fortune. Once you give a covert narcissist that type of clout, they're able to go under the radar a little differently than a grandiose. Now, the difference between the two, because we talked about before, Sean Puffy Combs is what you would consider a grandiose narcissist. He's very detected. You can just look at it and see it. But with Sean Carter, as Jaguar Wright said in another interview I had watched before, he is very calculated. He's very intelligent. He is patient. He moves very, very keenly. That's a snake.
Real slick.
Real slick. And so when you wonder why the information that we bring to you today was so easily able to happen for all of these years, allegedly in some cases, it's because he is very calculated and very intelligent. He is backed by a lot of resources and power, and he has a lot of contacts in the elitist status that keep him protected through all the negative, demonic, criminal like behavior that he actually passes through. So now that I explained to you what covert narcissism is, now we can go ahead and get into the episode and the meat and potatoes of it all. So I'm going to go ahead and just tell you a little bit about his childhood. His father and his mother were together, but he did say in this article that the father really didn't regulate or manage the emotions like a typical person would. The father just ignored his emotions. The mother was very present, but she also worked a lot. And so you put this child in this equation with these parents, it's dysfunctional, but functional because they're both present. And then at 11, which is a very crucial year, because around 11 is where children start looking for identity. And their identity is usually rooted in the partnerships and connections that they have to others, and also for how their parents stimulate them or not. And so when his father left at 11, that was such an integral, pivotal moment in his life, because that's where trauma began. And so he said when his father left, it's almost like his world became dark, and where he once had light and where he once had a heart, it all went away. And now he starts seeing life in, I need to be emotionless like I saw my father. I need to not let anybody get closer to me or close enough to me because I'm scared of abandonment. And I need to make sure that whatever I do in this life to become successful, I do it by any means necessary. So when you hear people say, what do you describe Jay-Z like with the episode that I talked about that before, and 50 Cent said he's a businessman, that's exactly how he thinks. He thinks for self-improvement, self-gain, self-monetary. He's going to elevate to the next level, and everything is going to be rooted in his own empire.
Whatever it takes.
Whatever it takes. And that doesn't always look good, because when God starts blessing us in this life, he doesn't bless us by any means necessary. There's a direction. There's decency, and there's order that follows and that precedes it. Mm-hmm. And so this already shows you how this man was created as a young child to be the adult demon that he is now. So I'm going to go ahead and move it over to Kyron so that he can get into some meat and potatoes of some of the things that happened in the industry.
So allegedly, Jay-Z stabbed a producer in the club claiming that he was selling bootleg copies of Volume 3, Life and Times of Sean Carter. And also allegedly, they were saying that it was behind this girl, Charlie Baltimore, that's her name?
Yeah.
That he was messing around with. But the dude, the producer that Jay-Z stabbed, was also a dude that she was messing around with. So it's a lot of allegedlies in there.
Yeah, and it's crazy, because just to piggyback off of what Kyron said, that's exactly what happened. It was alleged that when him and Charlie Baltimore were messing around, and let me go ahead and insert, this was during the time him and Beyonce were together. Now, I don't think they were married at this time. They were just in a relationship. And so this is just the beginning of his womanizing women all along. And he chooses younger women because they're easier to manipulate. I wanted to insert that as it relates to male narcissists. They choose younger women because they can control the narrative, control the mind, and control the movement of a younger woman. So in this case, Charlie Baltimore was just one of the many women that he was cheating on Beyonce with, alleged. And she was said to have moved on from that relationship when too many things got back to Beyonce about her. And so she decided to move on with her life and date somebody else, what most people would do. And so when she started dating this other guy who was alleged a producer at the time, that was the real person and the real reason behind this stabbing that happened back then. But it was wiped under the rug as a stabbing because someone was bootlegging his Sean Carter album at the time, or S. Carter. And so the other thing that I wanted to talk about is with Matthew Knowles. So I watched this video the other day, and it was like by one of these Celestial, one of the prophetess that I watch online. And Celestial was basically saying how Matthew Knowles, which is Beyonce's father, it was revealed to her in a revelation that that was her first handler. So when you think about how she was raised, she was rooted in Christianity and Christian faith through her mother taking her to church and allowing her to be introduced to God. When you think about some of her old songs with Destiny's Child, she always revered God in those albums. And so when she was under her father's wing, that was the first narcissist that she ever was acknowledged, you know, or was connected to, I should say. And so her father was her handler. He did everything he could so that she could be successful in the industry. And he had a lot of plugs in with producers and with labels and all these things. L.A. Reid was one of his guys. And so what happened is when he introduced Beyonce to L.A. Reid, L.A. Reid then connected her with Jay-Z. And then once that whole union solidified, that was the beginning of the end, because Matthew Knowles, from what Celestial said God revealed to her in a revelation, was that he passed her off as a spiritual sacrifice financially to gain wealth. And he didn't realize, though, that because I told you all that Jay-Z is a covert narcissist, he went behind his back, backstabbed him, kicked Matthew Knowles out of the equation and fired him, or got her to fire her father, and he took over from there.
Oh, wow.
And so when you're thinking about spiritual sacrifices, they don't always look like someone dying. Sometimes it might be putting someone else in another hands of another manipulative handler. And so in this case, this was her demise. So sometimes when I think about it, it's like somebody was done from the very beginning, because their patriarch was using them for financial gain. That's horrible. Who would ever do that as a father? But there are many parents that are abusive. And unfortunately, she dealt with an abusive man in her home, which is how she fell in the hands of someone that was worse than even her father.
Right. And before we go any deeper, cuz I think you should tell the people about the spiritual warfare that you've been going through while presenting this stuff to the people.
Absolutely. And thank you, Kyron. I got chills when he said that, because, okay, yesterday I was up late. If you guys haven't already realized by now, I do a lot of research. I spend hours upon hours. Sometimes at night I don't get a lot of sleep because I want to make sure I'm giving you factual evidence, right? And so yesterday I was on the phone with my boo. We were talking, and all of a sudden there was a crash. Like, I literally heard something say, boom. And I was like, what the hell was that? So I got up out of my bed, opened my door, because I close my door and lock it at night. And I went in the hallway. There's a beautiful portrait that I put in my hall. And it's been hanging for a long time. It's been hanging there, unscathed, untouched. Do y'all know that portrait was on the floor and the top of the frame was broke? I immediately, when I was on TikTok, I had saw this video from this Nigerian pastor. He was saying that you have to start anointing. He said seven signs of why you need to anoint your household. And in that moment, God just spoke so clearly. He said, get up, get your holy oil, and anoint your house. And this is not the first time that God told me to anoint my house. And what I'm realizing is, because of the type of work that God has me doing, because of the type of rank that Jay-Z and Beyonce Carter both have in the demonic satanic kingdom with Lucifer himself, all of the things that they did to initiate themselves in this society or in this hell, it is so thick that because God is using me to expose them, the enemy is tormenting me. He's trying to scare me, to try to stop me from speaking out against the things that God is trying to expose and reveal. But thank you, Holy Spirit. Even in this moment, what God told me is, you continue to be obedient. I will continue giving you direction on how you fight this spiritual warfare, because it is not carnal. You are going to face some things, but I will give you a hedge of protection and cover you while I use you to expose the things that I want brought forth. So when I tell y'all that I'm not coming to y'all saying these things because it's something gossipy or fun to talk about, I had to cry my eyes out the other day and ask God, why did you choose me to be the one to expose these things? I don't want to go through this kind of stuff. I've never been through stuff like this in my life. And God told me, I know it's heavy, my child, and I know you feel overwhelmed, but I want you to use the power and authority that I gave you, that I groomed you for during your fast, during your spiritual breakthrough, during some of the things that you've passed through that have been abusive in your own life. And I groomed you all the way till this point so that you have the power and authority to fight back against the enemy with my protection. So these things that I'm saying to you, they're not light. They're real. The spiritual realm is real. Mm-hmm. It's more real than everything that you see with your physical eye.
And spiritual warfare is also real. Like, it's a war. Like, when you go against the things of the enemy, trust and believe they're trying to come right back for you. But that's why you got to stay prayed up.
Absolutely. So every time that I study for these episodes now, I literally have to go into prayer before, during, and after. And once I'm done, I have to listen to gospel music, or I have to go to sleep listening to spiritual prayers, because I can't sleep just like a normal person does anymore, because I'm rooted in spiritual warfare right now. And so I'm going to just get back over to the episode, because that takes me right into when I passed through sleep paralysis a couple nights ago. Once again, I was talking on the phone to my boo, and then all of a sudden I start feeling this paralyzing feeling that I couldn't move. I couldn't speak. I couldn't do anything. And I was looking at him like, help me, but the words couldn't leave my mouth. And it was because that was before God told me that I needed to start praying and listening to different types of music before I go to sleep. Don't fall asleep to the stuff that you're researching. Fall asleep to my language. And so when I finally got out of this paralysis, I said, babe, and I told him what just happened. And he immediately went into a very bold prayer, rebuking the enemy's attempts to try to do anything to try to harm me. And then that takes me right into what I was researching when this happened. 444 is a song that Jay-Z released on his album right around the time that Beyonce released Lemonade. This was supposed to be their equal albums that they were talking about their his indiscretions and the challenges that they faced through infidelity because of Jay-Z. And so I'm going to just read these lyrics that God placed in front of me to share with you all, and then I'm going to go ahead and break them down. So the lyrics say, look, I apologize, often womanize. His proposal was, don't embarrass me, instead be mine. So when he asked her to marry him years ago, he didn't ask her, can you please marry me, like the traditional ask would be. He just told her, don't embarrass me. And that was his proposal to her. And he put this in his album. He said, I seen the innocence leave your eyes. I still mourn its death. I apologize to all the women whom I toyed with your emotions because I was emotionless.
That's demonic.
It's all demonic. And I apologize because at your best, you are love. And because I fall short of what I say, I'm all about your eyes. Leave with the soul your body once housed. And you stare blankly into space thinking all of the time you wasted it on all this basic S. I'm never going to treat you good. I would probably die with all the shame you did. What with who? Y'all.
Wow.
It's so crazy how we sing these things and we talk about this kind of stuff, but we don't realize that when we're singing these lyrics and fellowshipping with this demonic warfare, we're calling these spirits into our own lives. So when you listen to certain music, and then you might just be in your passing, your regular day-to-day, and wonder, like, why don't I feel good? Why do I feel like I'm frustrated? Or why do I feel anxious? Look at the lyrics that you're singing along with, or even just the lyrics and music that you're feeding your spirit. This is demonic warfare right here.
Yeah, he telling you right in the songs, like, a lot of people don't know that it's actually, like, spiritual laws. Like, the devil can't do nothing to you unless you give him some type of access. Yep. So he'll tell on himself all the time, but some people don't have, like, the eyes to see
it. Spiritual eyes.
Ears to hear. Like, we got to have discernment. So that's why these people say stuff like that in their lyrics, because the devil got to expose himself. It's just for you to catch it. And a lot of people don't catch it. They look over it, and they sing these songs, and it's life and death in the power of the tongue. So people sing these songs over themselves all day long, and then they start to wonder why they feel the way that they do.
Yep, that is a perfect interception to that, because it's so true. And I'm going to go into talking about Bonnie and Clyde and Lemonade, and then we'll get back into the meat and potatoes, because these are all songs that God wanted me to highlight in this episode. So with Bonnie and Clyde, basically, that was a grooming ritual, right? And when I say grooming ritual, I say that because in narcissism, they have to groom their victim before their victim is locked into their way of abuse, their emotional abuse, right? And so Beyonce is saying in some of these lyrics that she basically would do whatever she needed to do. And this is Bonnie and Clyde's an old song. So that shows you where the abuse started. And so she was basically saying that she would do whatever she needed to do to make him happy. Most of the lyrics that he sung about in this song was about material possessions and everything else outside of what you would think Bonnie and Clyde would be. What about courtship? Two people being together in love. And then he just groomed her so well to the point that even her verses only focused on to please him. He's talking about material possessions. She's talking about how she can make him happy. And it just doesn't make any sense, because when you think about Lemonade, now the reason why I did Bonnie and Clyde, because I'm going to juxtapose it now. Lemonade is over a decade later. And in this Lemonade album, she said something that is so important for you to really take heed to. She said, and I quote, "I whipped my own back and asked for dominion at your feet." This shows you all of those years prior to Lemonade, what he groomed her to do, worship him. She used to get on every award stage before when they first started dating, and she would always rever God. Thank you, God. Give glory to God for the success. She later stopped referencing God altogether, and she says, thank my husband. Mm. That's her God, little G.
Dang.
Idolatry is real, my loves. And when I tell y'all that you cannot have idolatry to anything in this life and think that God is going to give you favor and grace, he's not. Because even if you have idolatry in a space of ignorance, at some point you have to go seek him and get enlightened so you know what idolatry truly looks like. There are a lot of people that are married who have idolatry over their spouses. There are a lot of people who have children who have idolatry over their children. You can idolize people the same way you idolize things. And when you put a man, meaning just man, woman or man, before God, he is watching and he is judging.
Yes, he is.
Jay-Z groomed her to worship him. So now there is no God in her eyes. The only God she serves is her husband. The next thing I want to go over to is where we talk about Jaguar Wright, and Kyron will pick that up.
So Jaguar Wright has said that Diddy and Jay-Z for 25 years have been gatekeepers and have collectively blackballed people's careers, had people unalived and manipulated their way into the top of the industry.
And if y'all really don't want to take heed to that, this is clearly what happened when you think about everything we see going on right now with Diddy. I told you all, y'all heard it here first. I told y'all Diddy was being exposed, but there were others that were going to be exposed after him. There was so much going on within this highly weird industry that God is ripping the rug from underneath of every one of them one by one. And it's almost like it's cross-referencing, because they all have these demonic things that they've been doing collectively. So he's exposing them all at one time, but it's just different steps. Because obviously when you look at charging somebody with something, you have to have evidence. And so the prosecution in all of these cases at some point is going to have to really dig deep for factual evidence, because that's the only way you can convict somebody of something. And so when I go into some of his relationships, I want to focus on these relationships specifically, because these are pivotal moments in history where he was doing a lot of criminal activity and he was hiding behind his guise of success and being leading up to a mogul status. So Kathy White is a mistress that has come on the radar within the last couple of days on my radar, where basically she was supposed to be really cool, good friends with Claudia Jordan. I don't know if you guys know her, but she's another reporter in the industry. She was on the Housewives. Well, Kathy White and her were very cool, and there have been pictures and videos from back in the day when they were all hanging out with Jay-Z while he was still married to Beyonce, and they were all in a vibe. Well, when Beyonce first announced her pregnancy with Blue back in 2011, this is when Kathy supposedly was pregnant as well. Allegedly, she was pregnant at the same time as Beyonce's announcement, and she was going to come forward, and she told Jay-Z that she was. Well, because she said that to him, somehow sources allegedly said that Beyonce has a very jealous rage, because she also, like I told y'all, she plays with the occultic practices, so she has rage in her from a demon. And so she told him, you need to handle this situation. We all know sometimes that when people say handle things, sometimes that might be the people might not be here in the union with us no more. So that's what I'm going to leave that way. You make of it what you will. You do your own research. I have a ton of sources connected to this episode where you can find out what you need to. The next one is Carmen Bryan, which is actually Nas's child's mother. Now, she and Nas had a lot of contention, a lot of controversy back in the day because they were young. And obviously, young people don't always know what they're doing when they're becoming new parents. And so her and Nas had a lot of contention. Well, she was one of them ones that wanted to go get on with the next best person in the industry to do a dig to Nas. Well, allegedly, when she started dating him, well, this is not even alleged. I take that back. She did an interview with Vlad on Vlad TV where she actually told him during the time that her and Nas had all this contention, she was going to get back at him by dating Jay-Z. Well, Jay-Z started making a lot of lyrics undercutting Nas, throwing it up in his face in like very subliminal ways that he was messing with his chick. And so that's where a lot of their beef stemmed from. Now, obviously, a lot of this rap beef has always been swept under the rug to just be them beefing in the industry for one thing or the other. A lot of Jay-Z's beefs with people are all rooted in women. That's why God told me to focus on talking about his relationships that he had as affairs and even some of the relationships before Beyonce ever came to the ball game. So with this, you make of it what you will, but she said that what she noticed about Jay-Z, this is Carmen, Nas's child's mother, she said she noticed that he had insecurity issues, he was a very jealous person, and he was very immature in a lot of ways. Hence the reason why he was doing subliminal messages in his song shading Nas for stealing his girl. Imagine that. And that's how narcissism looks. I told y'all at the beginning of the episode, narcissistic people are insecure. They have to feel validated by the people they date, the things they have, and what they have going on in their life that makes them feel like they have power. It's a very inflated sense of self, but it's a very underhanded, inflated sense of self because there's a deep, dark insecurity that stays there and it never goes anywhere. The next thing I want to talk about is the fallout with Dame and the Aaliyah situation. Now, I talked about it briefly in the last episode, but I just want to emphasize on it this one. Jay-Z and Dame both were together with Biggs. Biggs, those two all came into the industry together. So it was Kareem Biggs Burke, Dame Dash, and Jay-Z. They all started Rockefeller, which was their independent label. Well, obviously, we all know that Jay-Z snaked Dame, took Rockefeller. Somehow Biggs wound up dead, which also is alleged that Jay-Z had something to do with him dying. And that's where Jay-Z rose to fame. And when Aaliyah came to the ball game, Aaliyah was doing what any young girl does. She talks to different people, but she decided she wanted to lock in with Dame. Well, Jay-Z's insecurity allegedly took the best of him, and so he felt away. So he kept making a trophy of, I'm going to do something to get him back so that I can make him feel the pain that I feel for him taking who I felt like should have been mine. He was looking for someone to be the next Mrs. Carter because he knew that with all the sacrifices and things that he was passing through in the industry and the occultic and Illuminati, that he had to find a woman. They told him he needed to find a woman that would give him a rise to fame. Now, this is alleged, but y'all know how the Illuminati works, because I told y'all. We didn't already told y'all. So with that, that was his task. So Aaliyah was supposed to be the next Miss Carter, but she didn't want to be. She didn't like him. She wasn't attracted to him in that way. She just was cool with him. So he had her supposedly unalived because he didn't like the fact that she didn't want to be his next Miss Carter, and she chose Dame. And then he snaked Dame and took Rockefeller from underneath of him, and that is where he started beginning to build his brand, the Rock label. And then that's where he found Beyonce to be the person that Aaliyah was supposed to be. And that's how they collectively rose to fame. Mm. Y'all, these things are very, very dark. And the fact that these Carters are walking around, her now with this sacred line, this hairline, and all these things that she's trying to do to separate, because there are alleged records that she did file divorce recently. It just hasn't hit the airwaves yet. She's trying to separate herself from him because she knows what type of things he's passing through, and she knows what type of judgment he's about to fall under. The Illuminati has already let him know that they were going to start releasing power from him in certain aspects. So he's already starting to go to court for deals. Like, there's a Bacardi deal right now with J.P. H. Morgan where the bank is basically telling him that they're not going to give him a certain amount of money for whatever reason. Now, the logistics of that you can find out in this interview that I pinned to this this post. But he's evidently going to court now because he's starting to lose money. Y'all, it's only the beginning. I keep telling you, God is telling me to bring this information to you all because it is very important for you to understand you need to turn away from your love and your adoration toward the Carters. Jay-Z and Beyonce are not good people, y'all. Spiritual death is real. Kyron and I were talking about that on the way to the studio. A spiritual death looks like God turning away from you because he's giving you so many warnings and chances, and you choose not to take heed to the things he's showing you, so he decides to turn away from you because you've turned away from him. Once a spiritual death happens, you might as well consider yourself a lifeless shell walking the earth until it's time for you to die and go to hell. That's it. And it's really that simple. And I can't be fluffy and colorful explaining this to you all, because it's not anything nice to say. It is sad. It really is sad, because there's so many people walking around playing with the fact that the spirit realm is real, and they think when they hear conversations like this, oh, it's whatever. Until the day that you go to judgment, and then you realize you're going to go to hell where you're going to burn for eternity.
Yeah, and it's real hard to come back from that. Like, it had to be like a real move of God for you to be able to come back from a spiritual death. And it's even a verse in Hebrews, I believe, that talk about this. It say, like, if we keep on sinning, knowing that we sinning, it's no more like a sacrifice for our sins. So, and that way, that ties in, like, with the spiritual death. Like, you keep on sinning and you knowing what you're doing is wrong, then it's a certain point where God just gonna let you keep doing what you're doing, and he not gonna come save you.
And that's it. Can you imagine knowing that your salvation, and which is a free gift God gives you, that you're not gonna have it when it's time for you to move on from this natural realm spiritually? I cannot imagine that. I say every day, thank you, God, for saving me from myself. Because the way that I once dwelled in this earth, I was headed straight to hell with Lucifer. And I thank God for reaching his hand down and pulling me out of my mess. And so when I use myself as an example, it's to let you know that I don't think I'm better than you. I was once you. Mm-hmm. So if you're under the sound of our voices, you need to take heed to what we're saying in these messages. Yeah, we're talking about celebrities, but it's not really as much about the gossip as it is much about education, about Christianity, about turning away from idols, and about looking at these celebrities that you rever so much and letting them be the example of what not to do. Not what to do, but what not to do. Mm-hmm. So we're going to go ahead and end with scripture, but I'm going to tell you what this YouTuber said. She said, and it was so eloquent, she said, people always ask God to show himself, and when he does, they call it a conspiracy. Mm-hmm. Many of what people are reporting right now, like me and Kyron, everybody looks at these videos, and until the stuff comes up with evidence, because they always need to see things before they believe it, instead of just believing that the word of God and having faith is all you need, they think that it's just a conspiracy, or these people are haters, or they just making this stuff up. No, my loves, it's not. It's a message and a warning from God. So God wanted us to use Romans 8 to tie right back into what Kyron just was talking about in Hebrews. And Romans 8 basically just talks about spirituality in itself and how God took the Holy Spirit, created Jesus and impregnated Mary so that it could be a vessel, a flesh vessel on this earth that could be able to be a sacrifice for sin. So when you think about Jesus's life being created just so that he can be born in the world and die for our sins, it's just to be a prototype of what his walk looked like, because he was without sin. He died for our sins, but he was not a man that sinned. And so we're supposed to model our walk toward everything that we watch Jesus do in the Holy Bible, because Jesus was the prototype. God wants us to understand we are right now in flesh. He created Jesus in flesh so that we had something to mirror what we look like and not just concentrate on the spiritual realm. Apart from the spiritual realm and naturally what you're doing, you're expected to not sin. When you sin, you have to ask for repentance, forgiveness. But that means turning away from sin. People think repentance means, oh, I'm sorry, God, I apologize and I won't do it again, and then I'm going to sin again and say it again. No. Once you educate yourself on the Ten Commandments very well, and you educate yourself on what repentance truly means, the definition of it, you have to turn away from sin. When you keep dwelling in sin and keep choosing every day that you wake up to do things you know God does not want you to do, you cause yourself the ability to go through a spiritual death. Thank you, Holy Spirit. That's all I have for you today. Kyron, did you want to add anything?
Yeah, I'm gonna read this verse and I'm gonna let this sit with y'all. Y'all can take it however y'all want. But Romans 8, verse 5, it say, those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God.
And that, my loves, will conclude this episode. We will see you guys next week. We're out.
Deuces.